Knight of the Round, sworn defenders of all who oppress the nerd. Now, on to the round table. Listen to what they say, for their words will guide you.
It's another nerdy night as my roundtable joins me, Ben, the Ridiculous Riddick, to discuss stuff. Mostly Nintendo tonight. It's going to be a great night. Joining me at my wonderful roundtable is the always fluffy, the always DJing, DJ Fluffkins himself, Sam Chen.
Wiki, 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 wiki.
Okay, that's it.
And our wonderful producer, the man who keeps the show running, and if there are any technical problems, you know to blame him, Mike DeMarco.
So this entire show, basically.
Yeah, that's all me. Every issue, obviously, is definitely my fault.
Oh, Sam. Gosh.
And Ben.
Oh, gosh. Hey, I haven't had technical issues on this show today.
Yes, not on NK Radio. Especially not today.
But, you know, we've got a really fun Nintendo-themed night, but before we get into all things Nintendo, into our next generation, let's talk about some active quests. Mike.
Yeah. Let's see. I've been packing, as I've said
what?
Before. No surprise. I started playing Persona again.
Ah, that game's so good.
Because it's great. And here's something I want to talk about a little bit. Today, Sam posted a Myers-Briggs test, which I don't know if I've talked about it on this show before or even with you guys before, but I love Myers-Briggs tests. I'm a big fan of like the personality testing and the science behind it. And the test that Sam posted specifically is one of the best ones I've ever seen. And specifically when it relates to the three of us, I think if you haven't before, you should take it. And the three of us should read each other's personality breakdowns.
Oh, God.
Because,
I'd be super curious.
That sounds a little personal.
No, it's a really good barometer about for working. Like, the problem with personality tests in general is people tend to, like, they lump people together and stuff, and it's really not like that. It's showing you kind of the way you Reference. Might think about things. And how you deal with people. And knowing how you deal with people, your strengths and weaknesses, and how other people that you work with deal with people, their strengths and weaknesses, it's really valuable as a tool. And
Mike, have you ever taken a class? Or, like,
I've taken psychology classes. Yeah.
Yeah. So I have a friend who used to teach Myers-Briggs.
Oh,
so he was, like, certified through the system. And honestly, that makes the biggest difference in really understanding how to use this information.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think I was in the same boat. Like, it's kind of fun to know different things. But, like, the second you're like, all right, well, Mike is an INTJ. What does the I mean about how Mike would interact with people versus how I interact with people?
Mm-hmm.
How does the N differ from an S? Like, that stuff becomes really interesting. And I'm a big fan of it, like, for exactly what you just described, which is basically teams.
Like, yeah, specifically for the three of us doing it, it would help us kind of just see how, like, where some of our weaknesses are at as a team and, like, why some of the conversations we've had before that are for us and not for the people watching, why those kind of things happen. You can see that kind of stuff in these personality tests. It's super valuable. You should get on it, Ben, because me and Sam already did it.
I'm taking it right now, actually.
During the show? That's very
unprofessional. You know, why not? I can host the show. I'm great at multitasking.
I will say this.
I'm highly motivated and energetic, okay?
Out of a very, like, interesting place, like, the guy who I did my test with, so I didn't actually take this systems test, he had a very strict policy about, like, he could not tell you your test results.
Oh, really?
Coming to the class. Because nice. In like a very technical sense, like, it's dangerous to, like, give someone a personality test without, like, being able to interpret it for them.
Right.
Like, the psychology behind it. So he just made a strict rule. Like, the test was free, But if you didn't show up for the session the day of, you would not get like your results.
That's a good idea, though.
Yeah, it really is. It really is. Like,
yeah,
it like because I asked it for a friend's because she wasn't going to be there that day, and he's like, I can't give it to, you, and I can't give it to her. Like, just it's, you know,
that's good.
It's not safe to do that.
But yeah, this site specifically that you posted that I'd never seen before. It's one of the most elaborate breakdowns of what each part means and how that trait interacts with the archetype as a whole and how they interact with other traits, other personality profiles.
Yeah, I also haven't seen one break down like strengths and weaknesses, romantic relationships, working relationships, like.
Yeah, it breaks it down pretty far. That's really cool.
I legitimately don't know the answer to some of these questions.
That's fine. You're
probably more towards the middle then.
Yeah, but it says try not to leave any neutral answers.
That's because if you're in the middle on a question, on like every if you're looking at I and E questions and you're in the middle on all of them, then you don't have a letter. That's the problem. Okay. You're 50% I and 50% E.
Maybe so I'm just a boring person. What if I'm a boring person?
Yep.
Maybe.
We already do that.
I don't think that's true.
So
that's impossible.
It's funny. The guy who gave me my task, like he was talking about when he first started getting into this, and he was like, "Yeah, like I really didn't buy it. I really didn't believe in it." And then I got the test result, and the test result was like, "People of your categorization often do not believe in personality tests." And he was like,
"Yep, there you go.
Okay."
So that's what I've been doing.
Well, that's great. Sam, how about you?
So two things that I've been doing. One is I've been listening to a lot of music. If you can see, I have a new pair of headphones.
No way.
Wait, is this another pair from the last week's pair that you had?
I knew they looked different. Damn it, Sam.
Wasn't that your resolution this year?
It was. I broke it. Well, so the sad part was like this pair specifically I ordered from Mass Drop. On my birthday,
which
was birthday?
February 1st.
Yep.
So it was like, this is a very long lead time, and I cannot say enough amazing things about these headphones. They're amazing. And they're like super light, and the clamping pressure is right, and the bass is amazing. Yeah, anyways.
Clamping pressure, so that's a phrase I've never heard before, but I automatically know what it means.
Yeah. But the other thing that I'm really excited about, which is a preview for next week, is I have finally caught up with Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Ugh.
In which sense, tomorrow night is the 2-hour season finale.
Yeah.
Right?
Excited.
And same. Last week's episode had a like little mention of Civil War.
Uh-huh.
Happened in it. And I'm just going to tell you, it's super exciting.
Well, I love it. It was a little mention, but then the whole episode kind of had to do with it, too.
Yeah, it was a really little cool. mention, but it was a big, like, thing.
It was really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Super excited. Okay.
I seriously can't wait. I've been playing Uncharted. Mm-hmm. Replaying Uncharted, I should say, because I don't have Uncharted 4 yet, and I won't really get a chance to play Uncharted 4 for a little while. So I thought, I have the remastered collection. I am going to go through and I'm going to get the Platinum Trophy in all three of them. It's not a completely unreasonable goal either. Yeah. The Platinum Trophies in those games are fairly simple. The hardest one in them is beating the game on crushing. And it's not even a difficulty thing as much as it's the most time-consuming part for me because I want to just blow through the game and get as many trophies at once as possible, which to me would be, okay, let's play on normal, get all the treasures, and, you know, work that way. Oh my god, Jesus. Sneeze was going to happen, but it stopped. It might come back. So,
we'll be able to look out.
I got the Platinum Trophy in Uncharted 1. Was that last night? I think that was last night.
That was the start of last night's stream, yeah.
And then I immediately jumped into Uncharted 2. And I love Naughty Dog. Like, their games are so great. And I've always liked their games, which is something that makes it even greater. But no, I've been having a lot of fun replaying them. They're beautiful games, and I think once I go through and do all the Uncharted's, I might go back and play through The Last of Us, because I really want to play that again. And now that I didn't sneeze, my nose just feels like it's going to leak for the rest of the goddamn episode.
Yeah, I totally want to deal with that
the rest of the episode.
That's going to sound great.
Yeah, that's kind of... That's been what I'm doing. As a matter of fact, I'm going to continue playing some Uncharted 2 after radio show tonight. Yep. So
I will probably be on as well in the chat, hanging out.
Yay! I like people in the chat.
Yep,
they're nice. So yeah, let's move into our first topic.
Yeah.
So Nintendo is starting to release information on what they will be showing at E3, citing that Zelda will be the main focus of the show and not to expect any new information regarding the Nintendo NX. This comes, might I add, hot on the heels of Nintendo saying that the NX would be a new family member alongside Wii and DS without replacing either of them. So I kind of want to start tonight's conversation on... how on earth does Nintendo think they can't have NX at E3?
Let's lay out the timeline first so that everyone understands. So E3 is coming in June, roughly, right? It's always in June, July of each year. So in the next 2 to 3 months, E3 is going to come. We're going to see all the new stuff. Nintendo is not going to show their new console. Now, they also announced, along with this announcement about E3, they announced that NX isn't going to come out this year, which everyone expected to come out in fall. Yeah. It is going to come out early 2017. I think they actually set a rough date. It's like spring, like March or something. Weird.
Right. No. And that's the part that confuses me the most. They plan on releasing a console in March before the next E3.
Exactly. They're not going to talk about it in the E3 preceding... the console release, which is weird. It's very weird. And now, the main difference, like PlayStation, Sony, and Microsoft wouldn't do this, because at least Nintendo has, for the past couple of years, they've already set this precedent of doing Nintendo Directs. So they at least have that to fall back on.
Right.
They'll do a Direct in the fall that is all NX related.
They weren't even at E3 last year.
Nintendo. Well, I mean, they were, but they didn't have like their normal conference. They haven't had a normal conference in like 2 or 3 years. They just do their Direct. But they were there. They showed Star Fox and they showed games at E3 still.
Did they? Because I honestly thought that was all just part of the Direct. I thought they were not at E3.
No, people played Star Fox at E3. Okay. Yeah. They just didn't have for a couple years now, they haven't had the same presence that Sony and Microsoft have had, because they don't have the big show conference on the stage and stuff. They pre-produce a Direct and they play it during their stream time on day 3 or day 2 or whatever. But yeah, it's still baffling that they're not going to go there for a console release that's going to be within the next year, before the next E3. That's crazy.
Sam, you know, I keep thinking, maybe I don't understand marketing well, but you work in marketing. Is there a reason, from a marketing standpoint, why they would not show up at the biggest trade show for video games and not show one of their biggest new things coming out?
I mean, I think there's a chance that if you look at the situation, Nintendo's coming at this thinking, like, maybe it's enough of a difference where... kind of coming to market early and letting people like tear it apart may shift kind of what they're doing, and that there's like maybe a final vision to all of it, but they don't want to release it too quickly, like, and have either like shareholders revolt over what it is, have fans revolt without kind of having a built out experience. It's kind of like if you started piloting like VR and you didn't have good games to like pilot it with. Right? Like, the underlying technology might be great, but if you don't have anything that's highlighting that experience, people might be like, well, what the fuck is this? Like, if they, I think there's a chance as a public company that like they don't want to take that risk. And I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, especially as a fan, right? Because
I was gonna say,
mean it's not a good enough product yet.
If that means that people aren't already trying to produce content for it, I am worried. But then again, Nintendo always, you know, just does whatever the hell they want, anyways.
Mm-hmm.
As far as worse. Yeah, and I mean, they haven't always especially recently they have not relied on third party to make games. Everything
like that goes into my biggest worry overall. It's like I want to preface this by saying we don't know anything about the NX yet officially.
Oh, exactly.
But from what we've heard, the rumblings are that they're really trying to get back to the core. They're making a powerful console that can compare to the PS4 and the Xbox One. They're trying to get third parties back. They're making the architecture accessible so that they can actually do ports of the other consoles and like they can all coexist for real this time. That does not lend any confidence to them not coming to E3, I feel like. The E3 crowd is who they need to market this thing to and that they're trying to get back to. And then they're not going to show us what it is until closer when it's ready to come out or whatever, which is still within a year. Within a year is pretty close, and they're not ready to show it. That worries me that they might not have confidence in it.
Well, yeah, I kind of see Sam's point because look at what happened with the Xbox One.
Mm-hmm.
They announced all of these like really great ideas, 1E3, that were truly great ideas.
Yeah.
The idea of game sharing,
revolutionary.
Everything was just awesome. It was starting to move more towards the digital environment that entertainment is, like it or not, moving towards.
Mm-hmm.
And we as fans, as video game fans, destroyed the Xbox 2 years before it came out. And, you know, I think it is a good point. Nintendo might have a lot of these plans in store for the NX and have seen the reception and are worried more about, well, our ideas are great, people are going to like them, but just explaining them isn't going to get people to understand why they'll like them.
See, I don't know. I think while it was a really bad move, it was to Xbox's benefit that they came out so early and they had the ability to backtrack. If Nintendo keeps this thing under wraps and then shows it 3 months before release, like, this is what it's going to be, and then it gets torn apart, they can't fix it. It's coming, and then that's what it's going to be, and then people aren't going to like it.
Yeah, but to Ben's point, like, even some of the stuff they were talking about for Xbox, it's like, it got torn apart in ways because, like, people just couldn't put their mind around it. And they didn't really understand how, like, market forces would react to it. And
I think the Xbox is just like the PSP Go, where it's still just too early. They're catering to a crowd that, like, people like us, generally like us, we have good internet, and we're very internet inclined, and we don't have really an issue with digital games. That's not the mass. Most people still want this. They don't have good internet. Maybe a lot don't even play online. That Xbox would not have been good for them.
I mean, no. So I understand that point, but like, I'm thinking of it from the standpoint of like, if you explained like Airbnb to someone before you could really stand up like a full-fledged product, people would have told you were crazy. What? Like, I'm just going to stay in some random guy's house? Like, girls would be like, I'm going to stay with some random guy who's going to rape me? Like, fuck no. But like, Airbnb doesn't play out that way. Uber didn't play out that way. And I feel like a lot of that comes from like having a little bit of leg room to build out a bigger marketplace for the product in a very small scale. Now, companies like Nintendo, Xbox, or Microsoft, Xbox, Sony, just don't have that leeway. And I think that's what Nintendo is playing for.
But I think part of what you described were technically services that can be rendered quickly, and you do it once, and then we move on. These guys are trying to sell a multi-$100 product that you're going to live with for up to 10 years, at least more than 4 or 5 years.
Well, right, but are you assuming the innovation's like hardware?
Yeah. they're attempting to innovate hardware. Nintendo's always done that.
Well, right, but like, wouldn't you argue that some of the stuff that Xbox got shut down is not hardware innovation?
It was attached to the hardware. Hardware was a big part of it.
Yeah,
it was built into the software. I mean, yeah, it was mostly software. It was systems things in place for how the Xbox environment was going
to
work.
Which, to Sam's point, these are things that can be fairly not easily changed, but they can be changed from Nintendo's point and sent to your pre-existing hardware.
Yes, could.
So it's not necessarily a bad idea, because they're not. It's not like if people are going to complain about the hardware, it's nothing that Nintendo would have been able to fix from now to release.
Right.
Compared to 3 months from release, you know?
So when we do see the controller in September or October and we get all pissed, they really can't do anything about it anyway.
And then they start coming up with, well, use this controller instead.
Yeah, use the Pro controller.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean,
so here's my question. Here's my question about all of this. How desperate do you think Nintendo is? Like, are they in a, like, this has got to succeed sort of thing?
No.
I think they are. They should be desperate, and they're not, and that's part of the problem.
Why should they be desperate?
Because they want the console market to work for them, and I don't think it's going to. Like, it hasn't since the Wii, and the Wii was a fluke. And they, for some reason, the company itself really wants home console to be a thing for them, when they really should just take their hit, excel at the portable, which they always have. They've always killed it on the portable side, and cut their losses, and really, like, they could be what Sega wanted to be when they dropped out of consoles, and they could do it way better than Sega did.
Well,
if they just did it.
So I understand where you're coming from, but to me, that's where I feel like this is like a bigger play for them. Whether it succeeds, like, I don't think they're looking at it in a position of saying, like, if we don't succeed, our company's bankrupt, right?
No,
like,
no,
it's definitely
at all.
Not that. I think they're saying, like, if we don't succeed, we need to fundamentally think of whether we are a, like,
home console,
essentially TV top console,
right?
And
the thing is, they've already changed their stance on a lot of things. The fact that Pokemon Go, which we're going to talk about later, is a thing, and Miitomo exists now, that was something Nintendo never would have done 5 years ago, or even like 3 years ago. They wanted to stay away from that completely, and now they're licensing out characters, they're licensing out properties, and they're making mobile games, and they're trying to get onto the internet, which is something they were never really interested in. It was kind of baked into the Wii, because it had to be, and the Wii U also continued to fail at being a really, like, connected console.
Right. Which is what I'm saying is that if they look at this and they think about it, it's like, all right, you know what? We're going to do this one last time, mm-hmm. but we're going to do it on our terms. We're not going to do it on, like, the mass populace. We're not going to do it on terms of, like, our shareholders, essentially, which we can argue whether that's right or wrong.
Right.
We're going to make one more, home console on our terms, and if it doesn't succeed, that's it.
Yeah, and that's good. That goes back into us not knowing what's happening, because the rumblings of the console itself are that, well, they are kind of course correcting, trying to get back up to the standard. But then we've seen patents for the controller, which we don't know if that's what the controller's going to be or not. They are Nintendo patents, but that doesn't officially mean that's what they're going to do. They are these innovative, weird controllers like the Wii was, and like the Wii U was. And like, it might just be another thing, another Wii, for all we know. And do we want that is the real question. I don't think we do, really. But maybe somebody
does.
I feel that Nintendo is starting to just dip into so many different markets that they do feel the console slipping away. Mm-hmm. This might be a last-ditch effort for them to make the console work, but they're not. It's not like if the console goes away, Nintendo's going to go away.
Not at all.
Not even close. Because, I mean, if you look at the stock for Nintendo over the last 20 years, yes, earlier last year, it was at its highest that it's ever been in the last, I guess, 10 years. But we're still, Nintendo is still sitting a lot higher than it did pre-2015. So
yeah, that's the misconception.
Nintendo doesn't need to be desperate.
Yeah, the misconception is whenever we bitch about the Nintendo or the Wii U or whatever, we're literally talking about their console identity. The company is totally fine. That company could stop doing everything they're doing and just live off of Pokemon and Mario forever. Like, they make so much money that way that it keeps the company afloat. And yes, I mean, I'm of that camp where it's like, I think they should drop home consoles and go third party, and I think they would thrive more than they ever thought they could in the console space in that sense. I mean, I think after the Wii, like, the Wii was so successful, they were kind of lulled into a nice security blanket where they thought they couldn't fail, when the Wii kind of was a failure overall. It was a financial success, but critically, it kind of died off very quickly. Imagine some of those Wii games on PlayStation Move. The PlayStation Move would have been a success if Nintendo was making games for the PlayStation Move. You know what I mean? Like, that's the kind of power Nintendo could have, even in the other console spaces.
Yeah, I mean, and the problem would there the is that it was someone trying to copy Nintendo and profit on their success.
Yeah, but if Nintendo wasn't a console maker, they could have done that themselves. If the PlayStation Move didn't exist and Nintendo was like, well, we make PlayStation and Xbox games, and now we want to make a game based around motion, they could have made the PlayStation Move themselves. It might not have been good as the PlayStation Move, because it would have been more like a Wiimote, but it would have had a stronger console to build off of.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I mean, if you look at how Nintendo operates as a company, and what they do from, like, their kind of, I guess, infrastructure standpoint, they're not doing stuff that's so unique that they need, like, essentially a closed console that they completely own.
Yeah.
Right? Like, if there were some, like, brilliant, and I'm not saying there aren't good integrations, quite frankly, I don't know. If there were some really brilliant integrations between their handheld and their home consoles just knocked it out of the park,
yeah,
I could see that argument. But, like, they don't have them. And
they could still do that, technically, if they were to make, like, apps on the 3DS or whatever that communicated with a game on the PS4 or the Xbox One. Like, they could do that kind of stuff, too, without having the NX or the Wii U. Nintendo just, they like almost like Apple, where they kind of want to have everything of their own, when they could kind of focus on what they're really good at and then use what other people are better at to make their stuff even better than it is. Like, I think that's a possibility for them. They just, right now, they don't see that, I guess. Or they don't care to see it and experiment with it. I mean, but they are starting to license out stuff. And, like, they didn't make Hyrule Warriors, you know, they gave that over to Platinum to do, because they make action games, and it was awesome. Smash Brothers was given to Namco.
To you, it was awesome, but critically, it was not proclaimed awesome.
Hyrule Warriors was well received. What? For a Dynasty Warriors game, it was very well received, especially on the Wii U. And they made a sequel on 3DS, which is not well received because that game's developed like shit.
Maybe that's what I was thinking.
It doesn't run well on a 3DS, which is the problem. It runs better on the new 3DS, and it still doesn't run great, because it's a Wii U game that's tried to be ported down to a portable, which isn't strong enough for it.
All right. you beat me on that one.
I know my Zelda.
So, something else I kind of wanted to discuss was the rumor that Nintendo NX is going to drop discs in favor of cartridges.
Yay.
Mike, you started explaining why you didn't think this would happen.
Shut you down.
My shutting him down was, shut up, we'll talk about it on the show.
Hey, still shut him down. Put him in his place. That's what I say.
I guess I would want to simplify the argument, I guess, and just try and keep it short, where it's just cartridges. I think for portables, they work. Like, you don't want to have disc on portables. We've seen problems with disc on portable. the SD card stuff are fine, and they're big enough that they can handle big games now. But on a console, cartridge-based system is just, it's a step back. We already had the issue with N64 where they decided to stick with cartridges, and then they lost Final Fantasy VII, which is regarded as one of the best games of all time, and it's what effectively made PlayStation beat Nintendo in their first console. Cartridges would just be a step back. If they're going to, like, make the jump, here's where I see that this might work as a thing. If they're going to do cartridges, essentially what they're doing is they're selling the digital copy of the game physically. So you're putting the SD card into your console, and then it's installing the digital version. Just like the same copy you would download off of the Nintendo store or whatever. That's a point maybe I could see. And if they do that, if they do it that way, I want that physical version to also count as a digital version. So that if I don't have that SD card with me or whatever, I could download the game off the store because I own it already. If they do it that way, I might be able to see it. Because then you're essentially just carrying a backup copy of your digital version on a SD card that you could carry with you.
Yeah, but see, like, that would be such a big change in how essentially the marketplace works. Like what are you going to do? Like, every once in a while, you need to plug in the chip to prove you have it again? Like, we're going back to that bullshit?
Not necessarily. The game itself, if you go and buy a cartridge from a store, it would have a specific identifying serial code that the console can also read when it's inputted, and that's tied to the digital version. So if you have a digital version download of a console and you try to plug into another console and play it, it knows that it's like in more than one place at a time or something, and it can react to that.
Similar. So once again, you're not only talking about changes to how you're functionally talking about an entire change to how the secondary market would handle Nintendo product. Or be unable to handle Nintendo product.
That
seems like a huge jump.
Everybody's trying to go for that anyway. All the makers.
I agree with that, but like, the technology has fundamentally changed and become smaller in the last 5-10 years to the point where, I mean, let's say it wasn't an SD card. Let's say it was even bigger than an SD card, right? And maybe had some of the performance benefits. I mean, you've played some of the like SNES RPGs on PlayStation, right?
Mm-hmm.
When they originally got ported.
Yeah.
Do you remember how bad that experience was?
I mean,
think about it. You had like 64 megs on a less than 64 megs on a cartridge,
right,
that loaded instantaneously, compared to a CD where it was like 5 to 6 seconds of load time just like leaving the house.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
So
how's that a difference between digital and SD?
It's not, but I'm saying, what if they're just trying to bridge the gap? What if they're trying to create a system where you aren't just putting in a disc, downloading 30 gigs onto your hard drive, and then like playing it? What if literally you're putting the cost in every disc or in every cartridge of your storage?
You could do that. You put in the cartridge and you can play the game.
I mean, think about it this way. It's like when Xbox did like the 4 gig console,
right?
The 360, and you were like, the fuck am I using a 4 gig console for? And they're like, oh, we use save files, and like it just wasn't effective or fast.
Uh-huh.
And reading off a DVD wasn't a good thing, right? Like, technology is better now, so theoretically they could bypass that experience by giving you high speed access on a cartridge, and then not require you to have a large hard drive to which you have to download and install things.
Hmm. I mean, I don't know.
I mean, if you're looking at this argument and saying like there are distinct markets still of individuals who simply cannot go digital only,
mm-hmm,
right? If I create a method or a module within my console where I can kind of essentially plug and play a hard drive in and not require it based on whether you wanted to use digital content or not, like that seems like a cost-effective way to get into a low cost market.
that's just buying cartridges and not buying digital.
I don't see how that's an argument against what I said, though, because mine would effectively be both at the same time.
Okay, so here's... I'm going to interject here, because I need to defend my point and reasoning to why cartridges sounds exactly like what it's going to be. Remember way back when all those... that feature list for the NX released?
Yes.
Yeah, from a fairly reliable source, I might add, one who had predicted the correct things for Pokemon games and other Nintendo, otherwise, you know, kept secret releases. And one of those things was explaining that the NX was a console that essentially functioned in the same kind of way, not that it was the same thing, but it functioned the same kind of way a Google Chromecast or Fire TV stick worked. Okay? We talked about this on the show. What was it? It was...
a while back.
I can actually tell you the exact episode.
Show number 7?
It was episode 29 where we talked about this.
Ooh, that was a while ago.
Less than 10 episodes ago.
Still this
that's,
year.
That's over 2 months.
those specific features are not things that Nintendo has come out and said, this isn't true. Nintendo's come out and said, oh, this, you know, stupid little controller that you've been saying, that's not true. But they haven't actually said that the feature list that was leaked isn't true. So my theory is, if that's what the console's going to be, then you're going to have a controller that has all the games plugged into it. Because essentially, you'll be able to play the whole game on the controller and stream the game to the TV. Because Nintendo is also still not calling this a handheld or a console.
Yeah. See, that's like a whole nother issue in my head, though. Because, like, at that point, why are they even making this? Like, this should just be the successor to the 3DS, then. And it should be a portable console that can stream to a TV. As a feature. And that's all it has to be. But, I don't know.
I know what you're saying, but I think... in the sense that, like, we necessarily couldn't grasp what a Wii was until we, like, put it in our hands.
Yep.
That might be the same situation here, where you say, like, okay, it's a successor to the 3DS. Like, what if they start taking away features that would be required to play 3DS games? Then it wouldn't really feel like a successor, right? Like,
well, I mean, in the same way that the 3DS is a successor to the Game Boy. Where it's like fundamentally a different thing, but it is a successor.
In the same way that every console is a successor to NES?
Yeah, I guess.
This controller that has 4 buttons on it is the successor to a controller that had 2 buttons.
Well, right, but when you talk about the features of a 3DS or a DS in general, the identifying feature is touchscreen. And... mm-hmm. If you're going to make a game that's a console game, but also a portable game or something, like, that's going to be a differentiating feature. You know, the Wii was a motion console, and then the Wii U is a tablet console, which is actually a lot closer to the 3DS than the Wii was.
Yes, because how dare we try to make a console that boasts the power, a handheld console that boasts the power of a station, like a in-home console. I wonder if anyone's ever tried that before. Oh, wait.
This thing?
No, the Vita.
Yep.
I mean, that's exactly what they boasted the Vita would be, except Nintendo might be able to actually make it work.
Well, I mean, at least comparable to a Nintendo console, I would say yes. I would not doubt they could make a portable console that's comparable to the Wii U, if not a little bit better.
I would not... okay, so if we're going to base the success off of the NX and put it... with the Wii U and the 3DS as far as sales go, I think we're going to be seeing sales numbers a lot closer to the 3DS than the Wii U.
You think? The NX?
Oh, yeah. At least in its opening.
I definitely think it's opening because Wii U had a very awful opening because it was terribly marketed. I think almost any console could open better than the Wii U did. But overall numbers, I don't know. Maybe the initial opening of the NX will be Wii U's numbers overall just because of what happened with the Wii U. But
okay. Like I said, like you said, I don't think that the NX has to worry about beating the Wii U numbers
Wii U numbers, you know, are bad. They're the opposite of the PS4.
Yeah. I think you're going to be wanting to base the success of the... You know what? I'll be willing to bet that the NX does close to PlayStation numbers.
PS4 numbers?
In its first three months. Yeah.
I don't remember PS4's opening.
I don't remember PS4's opening either, but...
You're still willing to bet.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, just because we're both as uninformed as we should be. At least if they
actually start marketing it.
Yeah.
In the next few months.
Just based on our both being uninformed about the opening, I would say, sure, I'll take that bet, but I don't actually have any horse in that race because I don't know how a PS4 opened specifically. I know it opened well. Yes. I know it's sustained itself, which is what's most impressive about it. It's consistently the higher selling console, and it's sold, over 40 million now, which is crazy. It's on par with the PS2 as its overall sales, which is, and no one thought could happen, really.
When did the PS4 launch?
2013 or 14? November 2013, maybe?
When the PS4 was released, it made a little bit more than 1.2 million sales, with the Xbox just below a million mark. And then Sony outsold Microsoft every month in the U.S. since then. It tells a little different story. All right. No, I gotta keep looking.
Yeah,
I've got like a 3 month chunk comparing 2015 to 2014, but I don't know what that means in the grand scheme.
Jesus Christ! There's a PlayStation 5 website. It's just
sure.
Okay,
it's just domain squatting.
Yeah,
gotta be.
I
bet PlayStation's laughing, so they're like, "There's gonna be no PS5." Loser.
Yeah.
Alrighty, guys. I'm going to move us on because
it's already,
we've been talking about this late for a while. Let's move on. Remember, guys, Nerdy Nights Radio is live on Twitch every Monday evening at 7:30 Pacific time, and you can be a part of the show by participating in the chat. You can then find the show on YouTube at nkrn.org/YouTube, and, of course, on iTunes. If you're on YouTube, be sure to hit that subscribe button. If you're on iTunes, please, 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 please go leave us a review. It helps the show. It helps us know what you guys like and dislike about it, and of course it brings more people to it because people are talking about it.
Visibility
and not, we're awesome and we're
not awesome. To be confused with Viz Media, the people who bring us Pokemon in the United States.
And Dragon Ball. And
speaking of Pokemon, Pokemon Go is entering the field testing stage in the United States very soon, allowing people to go onto their website and pre-register for a highly coveted spot on the test stage. Pokemon Go is a mobile game that allows you to try to catch them all while on the go on your iOS and Android device. Guys, Pokemon Go.
Yep.
I'm pretty stoked.
Oh, yeah.
I've been seeing the pictures, the PR pictures, and it just gets me even more excited. It's like a map, and you're looking at yourself on the map, and there are Pokemon. And that's great. And you know what's great about it is I walk to and from work, so being able to look at my phone and just catch Pokemon on my walk to work, it's going to be a blast.
You sound like the biggest fanboy ever. You're like, there's going to be Pokemon, guys! Pokemon! Like, yes, man. There will be Pokemon on your phone.
I don't know if people actually know this, but I'm a huge, huge Pokemon fanboy. I think...
Yeah. I will say this, Ben. I don't think you make it very clear. There is a lack of Pokemon paraphernalia. in your house. That's visible. You like don't wear the t-shirts. Okay, you got Amiibos, but that's not like real paraphernalia.
Oh, that's a topic. We're doing Nintendo tonight, but man, Disney Infinity. Fuck. Still can't believe it.
No, we're not talking about Disney Infinity.
It's Pokemon Go.
Pokemon Go. I mean, how do you guys feel about Pokemon entering the mobile stage, mobile platform?
About fucking time.
It is a step closer to the MMO that we all want.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
One step
closer. I mean, here's what I'll say. Like, I obviously have never had a 3DS. I kind of have some idea. But, like, I definitely have friends who are like, oh, I'm going to bring my 3DS to this new place, and it's going to do weird stuff because there's friends around me.
Oh, that stuff, yeah.
And I'm like, that sounds like a cool thing to do, but, like, am I really going to invest in another thing to do that with? Especially because I don't have, like, a bus commute to work where I'm, like, playing games, right? But, like, if you put it on my phone, yeah, I'd probably play it.
And
I definitely would.
You know, I have to say, Sam, you know what's great about Street Pass? When I went to Vegas, I didn't play on my DS at all, but I got 38 Street Passes while I was just...
Is that a high number?
I mean,
not bad, yeah.
It's a good number for only going to and from the airport and to a job interview. Yeah.
That's true. That's true.
Disney's always a good place to...
or conventions.
Conventions are a really good place, yeah.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, I think it's like Sam said, it's about time.
Yeah.
This is going to be what I think really shows Nintendo what can happen if they actually open up some of their really popular IPs like Pokemon.
Yeah.
Because who is it that's doing Niantic is the one doing Pokemon Go?
Something
I think.
Like that. It's the same company that made that other AR game that's like the spy game or whatever.
It is Niantic. I don't know how to pronounce it, but yes.
Yeah.
It looks like
it's
spelled that way.
I mean, if Niantic does this well,
yeah, Niantic.
It's going to be a really good show of faith from... Sorry, people just started screaming next door and it really distracted me.
Woo!
I assume the Warriors are doing well against the Thunderbolts right now. God, that just made me lose my complete train of thought.
Come on, Niantic, and if it does well,
I think this will open Nintendo's eyes to saying, well, crap, if they can do well, what happens if we let... don't know Square Enix make a MMO Pokemon game for us.
Oh my god. I never attached Square to making like the Pokemon MMO. Oh, that'd be so awesome. I know
like
not everyone loves
sign
it,
up
but
the
I love
Field Test
Song
Form
SV
requires you to have a Gmail account.
Yeah. Which is weird. Although my NKRN email worked because it's a Google Apps email.
Yep. No, Pokemon Go sounds like it. I don't want to get too hyped for it because I from what I've seen of it, I think it's a little lackluster. But
feel the hype.
It's still very much like that feel step it. In the right direction I want to see from Nintendo and from Pokemon. Like I think it's gonna be. For me specifically, we talked about today on Let's Play, but specifically for me, where I love Pokemon, but I fell off of Pokemon after like Red, Blue, and Yellow. Like that was my gen, you know, for Gen 1. After that, I never really played the series very much, just in passing. I never finished another game that was a main series Pokemon game. This has my interest again, and they're really targeting us, I think, too, our generation, Gen 1, because it's like. They're showing classic Pokemon, maybe a couple of others. They're showing Mewtwo. And it's very much like, you played it when you were a kid on your Game Boy. Now go out in the real world and play Pokemon again. That's really cool.
And I think a lot... Oh, like, I don't know what chased you away from Pokemon. But, like, at least for me, it was very much this idea that I felt like it was getting too complex. Like,
You created this series where, like, you convinced me that I needed to catch them all. Mm-hmm. And then you made it really hard to catch them all. Like, to the point where, like, I do not want to try to catch them all.
Right.
And so I wonder if, like, they're taking this, they're going to, like, kind of ease back and approach this as you were, as you should approach a mobile app, which is, like, for the masses, relatively simple, but, you know, give some elements to a hardcore player that they'd be interested in playing.
I think something wrong with your perception of catching them all, though, Sam, is each game rewards you for two different things. Catching the regional, everything on the regional Pokédex, and then catching everything on the national Pokédex.
Right.
Which the national Pokédex is all 751 of them.
Yeah. That sounds complicated to begin with.
But
the game itself is contained and has, like, 150 or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Every game is the same, but then
right.
Because they keep adding to the universe, it branches out into okay. being bigger and bigger.
So that, I think, is more a testament to Pokemon being smart. It's like, we want to bring people new monsters, but we don't want people to not go after
right.
or feel left out because we took out the old ones.
We don't want to ignore what came before. It's yeah. all still there. Yeah.
I'll tell you where, like...
Don't want to ignore those leech seeds we put out in the world.
Like, I'll tell you where, like, it really felt like they lost me was when I was told, like, you could only catch certain Pokemon certain times of day and certain, like,
well, that was, like gold,
weird
gold
other,
gold
like,
silver,
factors.
Wasn't it? That was the next
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, I mean, it probably was a long time ago.
Yeah.
I mean, it was in the... I think it was gold and silver, think, which was the second iteration
think,
of the game.
I think second gen added day-night cycle to the game.
Yeah, like... Like, even that to me was just like, you know, like, maybe I don't care.
See, that's interesting, because, like, I'm kind of with you. Like, it keeps getting more complicated, and the longer you stay away, the more complicated it gets. But I'm not, but like, I'm not discouraged by complicated games.
I mean, the thing is, Sam, like, I stopped playing Pokemon after Gold, Silver, and Crystal, which was the second generation. And didn't pick it up again until, like, three generations later. Still felt like it was easy to get into yeah. and no different than the previous game that I played. Just yeah, looked different.
Yeah, I'm definitely willing to say that it's a perception thing on my end, right? Like, I'm not saying, like, I picked it up, then, like, felt like the game was too complicated and put down the game.
Yeah.
Like, it's definitely a perception element. But, I think that ends up being a barrier for some people. Like, even now, there's plenty of games that, like, you, I, or anyone else thinks, yeah, hey, it's easy to get into. Like, I'll help you out, I'll do this. And people are like, nah, it's too complicated.
No.
And you're like, but it's not. And they're like, yeah, it is.
For me, it's just that it's portable. I grew out of portable games pretty quickly, getting out of, like, middle school, high school. And I just, the only portable game I've played in the past, like, legitimately in the past, like, 10 years, is Persona 4 Golden. That's it. And that's only because it's like, that's the only way I can play it. If we got console Pokemon games, I would.
You can play it on the console.
You could.
Get a PlayStation TV.
Yeah, PlayStation TV. That's a whole different thing, Ben.
I mean, I guess for me, like, portable gaming is what got me into gaming to begin with. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, I played N64, I played my Genesis, but I didn't really play video games a lot until I got my Game Boy. And then I played video games all the time. And I think one of the reasons maybe that I haven't gone away from portable is, like, growing up, I moved a lot and traveled a lot, and guess what? It's proving that my adult life, I still move a lot and travel. So portable games are still very important to me. So I can understand the non-portable aspect of the argument, but the too complicated aspect, Sam.
I'm like, this is my reasoning, but this is why I'm excited for Pokemon Go. You're
No, I know.
No, you're an idiot, Sam.
So let's veer back into Pokemon Go.
That's honestly what I'm excited about, is I'm excited to see more people get into Pokemon because it's accessible on platforms that almost every are in the hands of everyone.
It's a platform that everyone's already invested in, and it's already in their pocket all the time. Like, Yep. They don't have to go buy a 3DS or whatever, and they don't have to carry it with them and keep it charged. Like, it's on their phone.
You already have to carry it with you and keep it charged.
Yeah, but it's your phone. You always have your phone on you and keep it charged. It's not another thing that you have to take care of and maintain. It's already
Sam knows
there.
That I do not always have my phone charged.
No, he does not. I don't know how either. Like, it literally makes no sense that someone I consider, like, relatively tech savvy could be like, hey, Sam, I have 2% battery.
To be fair, that was when I was on my 5S, and that thing's battery was shit. Now that I've started using,
more reason for you to carry a backup battery.
Yeah, and yeah, I lost my Mophie. I can't find it.
So Pokemon Go is awesome, guys.
Yes, Pokemon Go is awesome. I can't wait. I really, really hope I get into the field testing.
I really, really hope it's good. That's what I hope most of all. I hope it's actually a really good game.
The thing that saddens me about the field testing is if I get into it, I'm not allowed to talk about it.
Oh, yeah. That's true.
Like, I'll probably tell you guys about it, I won't be talking about it on the show, which is sad.
Oh, well. Have they announced a date, not for the field test, but for the game? Do they have a release date yet? It's just TBD.
It's just TBD. Okay. I've been trying to find the actual release date since we started talking about it. Everything I see is...
They probably want to get all the worldwide testing done, because it's probably going to simul release, isn't it? It's going to come out at the same time.
I would imagine. Yeah. And, you know, the game is supposed to come out this year.
Right. Yeah.
So
we at least have that.
I am okay with that being that. Mm-hmm. I do agree. I hope it's good.
Yep.
You know. That's Pokemon Go. Let's continue the discussion, because I have a feeling this is going to be a big one. Mm-hmm. But real quick, don't forget to catch us on our other shows throughout the week. My sister Anna and I host a comic book club show every Wednesday called Nightly Novels. Last week, we read Iron Man Extremis, and not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday, we are going to be reading Deadpool's Art of War. So be sure to check that out. This one, on the off Wednesdays, I do a news show all about comics, and that will be live this Wednesday. Every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, you can catch Mike hosting the Nerdy Knights Let's Play podcast. Mike, there are a few things Let's Play related on the website right now. Go ahead and tell us what it is.
Yeah, we finished two games now on Let's Play, which is pretty awesome. Or the old Wreck Attempt show never could say that. We never actually finished a game completely. Because all our games were long. So me and Sam played Star Fox 2, which is an unreleased Super Nintendo game. And we beat that. 6 episodes, all done, all online. And then me and Ben played... We did some live streaming one-shots from Lego Avengers to get ready for Civil War. And all 3 of those are online. So that Let's Play series is technically completed. And it's all online. Ooh, yeah. And you can watch it. And then ongoing, we've got Final Fantasy VII, which will be going on for a long time, but we're like,
probably forever,
maybe forever, but we're like 40 episodes in or so. About 40.
It would be really funny.
Yep.
If like at some point during the release schedule of the Final Fantasy Let's Play, like all of a sudden it's like the remake version.
just
we upgraded the graphics, guys!
Because it took too long.
Oh god, that would be fantastic.
That'd be pretty great.
If for some reason the show goes on that long, and we're not finished with the game, I say we just...
I'll rush through FF7, the remake, up to the point where we're at, and then we just continue on from there.
Yep.
That'd be pretty great. So yeah, Final Fantasy, Star Fox, Lego Avengers, all online. Watch it, subscribe, like it, stuff.
Do it. Do it now. And for all these shows and more, visit www.nkrn.org. Yeah. Moving on to our final topic of the evening. Nintendo started with toys, moved into games, dominated the handheld market, and is breaking into mobile. And now, they want to get their feet wet in some movie production. I believe the news just broke today.
I think so. Maybe today, maybe yesterday, but it's very, very recent.
There were some rumors, so yeah. And I think they got more detail today.
Yes. Yep. So yeah, Sam is completely right. It was yesterday that the rumors were flying around, and then it got confirmed. So real quickly, I mean, what happened was an interview with Asahi Shinbun.
Oh, Ben.
You know what, Mike? I don't see you taking charge on trying to say these names.
You're the host, and you have all the links and stuff.
Well, technically,
I'm wearing the green shirt, so technically I'm the host.
Damn it. Damn you and your logic. Anyways, so how would you say that name, Mike?
What is it?
Asahi Shinbun.
No,
it's probably Asahi Shinbun. Probably, yeah.
Okay, so Asahi Shinbun. It was the interview was between him and President Tatsumi Kimishima.
That's acceptable.
That's acceptable?
Yeah, go ahead.
Confirmed the company has plans to produce feature films and is exploring a production system in which, quote, we can do as much as we can ourselves, end quote. I mean, this isn't the first time they've expressed this interest.
Yes.
Rumors were starting to fly around last year that Zelda, Netflix original, would be coming out.
Yeah.
So, Mike, Sam, you guys... Well, real quickly, Sam, you're very much into television, TV shows.
Yes.
Mike, you like anime.
Sure, yeah.
I think.
Enough that you could say, out of this group,
I like anime.
Out of this group, I'm probably the anime fan, but I wouldn't really. Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
I'm anime classic. Thank you. No, I'm just kidding. Keep going.
How do you guys feel about this? Sam, from the average TV show watcher, where are your thoughts on this, Sam?
I mean, I think this is cool, right? Because, like, you're getting a franchise that has a lot of, or you're getting access to franchises that have a lot of, like, characters that people know and love, you know, even if they have never talked before. And so, like, basically getting access to a universe that's already a visual medium and then telling a cool story in it could have a lot of potential. But then you inevitably kind of face against this, like, this idea of, like, the video game, like, movie curse, right? Where, like, there just aren't great video game movies. You can argue that there probably aren't great video game TV shows either. So I think it all comes down to, like,
I love the Sonic the Hedgehog TV show.
That was actually pretty good.
Yeah.
Actually pretty good.
Oddly enough, I didn't think of Sonic the Hedgehog. The first thing that came to mind, I was trying to think, what video game TV shows were there? And I thought Mortal Kombat. There was a Mortal Kombat TV show.
I didn't even know there was a Mortal Kombat TV show.
It was, the first kind of like movie
was okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think I look at it and think, like, it all just comes down to who's making it and how they're going to do. Because, like...
Well, it sounds like Nintendo is making it.
Well, yeah, no, I understand that. And, like, to me, that's iffy. That's really iffy. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they've got the guts to, like, really push it the way they need to. Because I have a feeling, like, you need to have enough leeway to depart from the game itself or, like, canon, so to speak, to create characters in the world or to recreate them in the world.
You know what's funny? We all couldn't figure out a TV show based on a video game. Pokemon.
I don't know. I almost feel like anime is different. I'm sure they're going to go an anime route eventually if this is the path they're going down. But for some reason, I don't
think of anime. I think that is their plan, is going the anime route.
Well, the animation route is different, like CG, right?
Toto. So here's what we got. Is it Toto? Toto also noted that Nintendo isn't interested in producing live-action movies with Kimishima, citing the 1993 Super Mario film as the main reason why the company is leaning toward, quote, anime-type content where Nintendo should produce as much by itself as possible, end quote.
Okay, then never mind.
I mean, so you look at this, and I think about a couple of different things. Like, one, have any of you watched the, like, non-localized version of Pokemon?
No.
Okay, so I haven't either. But the localized version, at least in my mind, was very, like, kid-oriented.
Yes, it was.
Right?
It still is.
Which was the demographic that we were. Like, I remember, like, I actually really liked the localized version of, like, Digimon. Like, I thought, like, the jokes actually landed much better than I think a translation would have. But I think for this to be successful, it's got to approach a much broader audience. Mm. And... that's where I don't know if they're going to be able to do it.
I think I'm of a different mind, actually. I think we're looking at TV shows and stuff. I think I would rather see them go almost a DC animated route where they do standalone movies of all these series that are animated, and they are just, they're awesome. Like, they're just well-contained stories that are well-told. They have good voice acting. They've got good scripts, and just make them and then put them out there and just see how they
do. And I mean, they have the IPs that would work really well for that. Like, imagine a Fire Emblem.
Oh, Fire Emblem would be a fantastic, like...
Like, that's the first one that came to mind for me.
That one could probably work as an anime, like, straight up. Like, what? That one could probably totally work as an anime, like a season-long, two-season-long anime.
Yeah, I mean, they're talking more about movies, right, though.
Fire Emblem specifically, I'm like, that could be like a Game of Thrones type anime. Like, not exactly Game of Thrones, but just like that sort of tone where it's royalty, like warring factions and stuff. And
How about Bayonetta?
They don't.
They've got the properties that if they set out and did it, they could be great.
Yeah.
And I mean, both Fire Emblem and Bayonetta, they're. I mean, Bayonetta's an M-rated game.
Who published the Star Fox anime that just came out?
What?
Did Nintendo make the Star Fox anime short that just came out, or did they outsource that?
Oh, that is a good question. And I bet Sam's already looking it up.
I'm looking it up, too.
But I mean, like, I don't know. Like, I would love to see... And they could do your Bayonettas, your Fire Emblems... for the older audience.
Yes.
And then they still have, you know, you could do the Kirby show or the Kirby movies and the Yoshi movies. Mm-hmm. And
didn't Kirby have a show?
I don't know.
Kirby definitely did.
Kirby right back at you.
I mean, here's the thing. I think for mass market American audiences, and I won't necessarily say that this is where they should target, because I'm not sure that's the right answer. Right. But, like, I feel like if you look... hold on. I didn't think Tom was in the chat anymore.
There's someone here.
Sorry, Tom.
I thought he left the chat, because I checked the viewer list, and he wasn't there.
And Tom, I'm sorry, I wasn't watching the chat. Usually I like to watch the chat and talk to you.
Usually it's more active, but...
Yeah.
That didn't sound stalkery at all. I think, like, to me, shows like Avatar on both the original and Legend of Korra, like, do a really good job of hitting this, like, intermediate mark between, like, too young, too old.
Yeah.
Where, like, it there's a really broad swath of audience. And so my question is, like, can they find that, like, middle point? Where it's not like they're making an anime that's suitable for the Japanese audience, and then they're going to do, like, a translation or a dub version.
Mm-hmm.
Like, are they going to approach it and think, like, you know what? What if we produced content for America?
Mm.
Like, in an animated form? Which, like, I think there's some success, but...
Then we're just going to get Angry Kirby all the time. No, that was a joke. Nobody cared.
I didn't get that.
In Japan, Kirby is like a an aloof character.
Uh-huh.
Like, if you look at box art and stuff, but in America, he always has slanty, angry eyes.
Oh.
It literally, if you look at the box art for the games, the Japanese version is just normal Kirby, and then American version, slant eyes. They're angry.
Because Tom wants us to say hi to him.
Hi, Tom.
Just, there we go. We did it.
Oh.
Yeah, I don't know. I think, God, there's, the thing is, we really just don't know what Nintendo's going to do. At least, what I don't know the publishing houses that did these, but I know the Star Fox anime was interesting. It wasn't great, it wasn't bad. It was just kind of in the middle. The Pokemon anime that they did, not the show, but the OVA.
I liked that
was
one.
Was amazing. I don't know if that was them so or good. Not. But it was really good. If they do stuff like that, I'm all in. Because that three-episode OVA was fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Was that really only three episodes?
Yes, it was three episodes.
Gosh. I loved all three episodes.
It was awesome.
That part in Lavender Town.
Yeah.
With the little ghost that appears, but God.
It's a really good. I love when the starters
And he fight. Actually caught them all.
Yeah.
Pokemon.
Yeah.
Pokemon.
Unlike Ash.
Oh, Ash, he's the worst Pokemon trainer ever.
Gosh, I feel like we could do a topic on how Ash isn't the worst is not the worst Pokemon probably. Trainer ever.
Now I do want to go. I want to circle back and talk about that comment about Super Mario Brothers the movie.
Okay.
Obviously, that was a bad movie.
Okay.
We all know this.
I'm glad that we all agree.
Everybody
on
knows
that
was a weird fucking movie. But to judge what they are going to do now on something that was over 20 years ago, I feels a little short-sighted. Or I guess long-sighted, if you think of it that way. Things have changed a lot since that Mario Brothers movie. For instance, this year we're getting an Assassin's Creed movie that actually looks pretty cool.
I don't know. I agree. The movie looks cool. I still just don't agree with the random Kanye.
Well, yeah, but that's not the movie. That's marketing department making a trailer.
Marketing department should stop being stupid.
You would think, but this is not... Fucking look at Ghostbusters. I know you don't care about Ghostbusters. We don't know if that movie's actually going to be bad, but that trailer hurt the movie, and that's the marketing department fucking up. countless times marketing departments ruin movies based on trailers. But point is, video game movies have come a long way since Super Mario Brothers and Street Fighter and stuff. I mean, we're five or six movies deep into Resident Evil now, too. And while people tend to say they don't like them, those movies sell every time.
Yep.
And there's a reason there's six or seven of them. People go watch them because they're actually fun movies to watch. I don't see why you wouldn't, especially in the space that they could do or outsource people to do a CG Mario movie or even live action movies for Zelda or Metroid. You know how cool a Metroid movie would be live action? They could do it. If they put enough money towards it, they could do a really cool one.
And put Jon Favreau in charge of it.
Sure. I'd totally be down for that. Jon Favreau or Ridley Scott?
Ridley Scott one would be pretty good.
The Russo brothers?
Those would be two very different movies.
Yes.
A Ridley Scott movies. Metroid and a Jon Favreau Metroid.
But a Ridley Scott movie could be Alien. It'd be awesome.
What? A Ridley Scott movie could be another Ridley Scott movie?
Yeah, but Metroid. The Metroid version, the alien version of Metroid would be pretty sweet.
Yeah. I mean, there are just so many universes where I feel like they could have success and could have some fairly easy success. It's just a matter of if they actually, man up and do it.
Yeah. We'll see.
I haven't even... I'm not paying attention because I'm actually watching the trailer for the Assassin's Creed movie.
Oh.
Because I haven't seen it. That's pretty badass.
Yeah, it looks fine. I was. The news came out today that the movie's 35% flashback or history, and then 85% current time, present time, or whatever.
That's 110%.
That's a little weird. That's a little
120%
weird.
120% actually.
Whatever. The movie's really good. It's got more than 100%. That seems a little odd to me if you're trying to do an accurate movie, but I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt. We'll see what happens. It looks fun, at the very least. it looks like they do parkour, and he stabs people with wrist blades. So I'm gonna watch it.
Yeah.
In the same vein, though, I would love to see Metroid or Zelda or live action done seriously. You know, like they're doing Assassin's Creed.
I think with some of those, I would want to see like more long form.
Yeah.
Right. And I think with some of them, I'd be okay seeing like a movie, but it actually harkens back to something that did you guys watch? Okay, so one of the I listened to Pop Culture Happy Hour, and they did a interview with the Russos on talking about like kind of their experience moving from TV to film, mm-hmm. and they're talking about how like
once right, they did Community, right?
Yeah, they did Community, they did Arrested Development. I think there's one other one that I didn't watch that they did.
Yeah.
But essentially they talked about how once TV stopped being about Nielsen ratings as it used to be, it started opening up the doors to better TV content, which actually ended up pushing movies into like bigger blockbusters mm-hmm. because like it now becomes an event to get you out of your house and into a theater where he was like, if it's like a family, right, like, and it's mom and dad going out for the night, it's probably like a $200 cost to go see a movie. Like, between tickets, maybe food before, maybe snacks during, and then like a babysitter, it's like an expensive ordeal. So he's like, now every movie has to live up to this blockbuster hype because, like, you could just watch House of Cards at home.
Yeah.
And, like, that costs you $8 a month. And so I think it's actually a really interesting way to look at how future IPs can be produced on either film or film cinema wise or TV because you could afford to make a TV series. Like you're not going to have like maybe the best like Jungle Book like graphics, but you can afford to do that and stretch it out for even longer. And maybe that's a better revenue stream for you than your like one hit movie.
And it's much better if narrative is ultimately your important aspect. Being able to stretch a story out over 10 hours instead of 2 or 1.5 and actually have characters that develop is much typically more interesting, especially when, you know, some of these stories, if they're going to try and tell them at all, like imagine a Zelda movie, you know, how do you do a Zelda movie that's actually reminiscent of the game where he's supposed to go through like a series of dungeons and solve all these puzzles? Like you can't really do that in 1.5 hours. It probably wouldn't even really do it in 10 hours. But at least in 10 hours, you can kind of move through time and develop the characters throughout the whole journey instead of just being like, here's Link, here's a montage of all the dungeons, and here's him fighting Ganon. Movie over. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, which is why, like, if they did a show or a movie, like, they would need to take a lot of creative liberty, which I think I'm okay with because, like, I enjoy the IP enough, but, like, I don't know if Nintendo's that company to be like, yeah, okay.
They have the ideas and they make the great games, but can they actually do something else with it other than make really good games? I think it'd be better if they outsourced. Give it to people that can handle it, that know what they're doing.
Yeah. I don't know. I still like the idea of the more DC animated movies idea because they're great.
Yeah, I would do something between a mix of DC animated and like Netflix series, depending on the property itself. You know, some things would lend themselves to better to a standalone movie. Some things could use 10 hours to kind of unfold. And I think that's how I would handle it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
All right, let's go ahead and close out the show for tonight. What do you guys think?
Yeah,
sure.
All right. Everyone, thank you so much for joining us. Remember, you can find us all over the internet. Mike is at Mike V on Twitter. That's M-A-I-K-V on Twitter. You can find Sam Chen pretty much everywhere on the internet as DJ Fluffkins, and I really do mean everywhere.
Yeah.
You can follow me on Twitter at BeRidiculous. That's BRIDDICKULOUS, because I am ridiculous all the time. You can follow everything Nerdy Knights related at nerdy_knights on Twitter. And of course, on our website, www.nkrn.com. nerdyknights.org. Thanks again, everyone. It's been an excellent night, and I officially dubbed the Nerdy Knights of the Round. Go out and defend the realm of the Nerdy Knight, and until next week, remember, it's dangerous to go alone.